Chapter 4. What are things made of? In Victorian times, a favorite book for children was Edward Lear's Book of Nonsense, as well as the poems about the owl and the pussycat, which you may know because it is still famous, the jumblies and the pobble who has no toes. I love the recipes at the end of the book. The one for combobbleous cutlets begins like this. Procure some strips of beef, and having cut them into the smallest possible slices, proceed to cut them still smaller, 8 or perhaps 9 times. What do you get if you keep on cutting stuff into smaller and smaller pieces? Suppose you take a piece of anything and cut it in half using the thinnest and sharpest razor blade you can find. Then you cut that in half, then cut that half in half, and so on, over and over again. Do the pieces eventually get so small that they can't get any smaller? How thin is the edge of a razor blade? How small is the sharp end of a needle? What are the smallest bits that things are made of? The ancient civilizations of Greece, China, and India all seem to have arrived at the same idea that everything is made from 4 elements: air, water, fire, and earth. But one ancient Greek, Democritus, came a bit closer to the truth. Democritus thought that if you cut anything up into sufficiently small pieces, you would eventually reach a piece so small that it couldn't be cut any further. The Greek for cut is tomos, and if you stick an A in front of a Greek word, it means not, or you can't. So atomic means something too small to be cut any smaller, and that is where our word atom comes from. An atom of gold is the smallest possible bit of gold. Even if it were possible to cut it any smaller, it would cease to be gold. An atom of iron is the smallest possible bit of iron, and so on. We now know that there are about 100 different kinds of atoms, of which only about 90 occur in nature. The few others have been concocted by scientists in the lab, but only in tiny quantities. Pure substances that consist of one kind of atom only are called elements, same word as was once used for earth, air, fire, and water, but with a very different meaning. Examples of elements are hydrogen, oxygen, iron, chlorine, copper, sodium, gold, carbon, mercury, and nitrogen. Some elements, such as molybdenum, are rare on Earth, which is why you may not have heard of molybdenum, but commoner elsewhere in the universe. If you wonder how we know this, wait for Chapter 8. Metals such as iron, lead, copper, zinc, tin, and mercury are elements. So are gases such as oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, and neon. But most of the substances that we see around us are not elements, but compounds. A compound is what you get when two or more different atoms join together in a particular way. You've probably heard water referred to as H2O. This is its chemical formula and means it is a compound of one oxygen atom joined to 2 hydrogen atoms. A group of atoms joined together to make a compound is called a molecule. Some molecules are very simple. A molecule of water, for example, has just those 3 atoms. Other molecules, especially those in living bodies, have hundreds of atoms all joined together in a very particular way. Indeed, it is the way they are joined together, as well as the type and number of atoms, that makes any particular molecule one compound and not another. You can also use the word molecule to describe what you get when 2 or more of the same kind of atom join together. a molecule of oxygen, the gas we need in order to breathe, consists of two oxygen atoms joined together. Sometimes three oxygen atoms join together to form a different kind of molecule called ozone. The number of atoms in a molecule really makes a difference, even if the atoms are all the same. Ozone is harmful to breathe, but we benefit from a layer of it in the Earth's upper atmosphere, which protects us from the most damaging of the sun's rays. One of the reasons Australians have to be especially careful when sunbathing is that there is a hole in the ozone layer in the far south. Crystals, atoms on parade. A diamond crystal is a huge molecule of no fixed size, consisting of millions of atoms of the element carbon stuck together, all lined up in a very particular way. They are so regularly spaced inside the crystal, you could think of them as being like soldiers on parade, except that they are parading in three dimensions, like a shoal of fish. But the number of fish in the shoal, the number of carbon atoms in even the smallest diamond crystal, is gigantic, more than all the fish plus all the people in the world. And stuck together is a misleading way to describe them if it makes you think of the atoms as solid lumps of carbon closely packed with no space in between. In fact, as we shall see, most solid matter consists of empty space. That will take some explaining. I'll come back to it. All crystals are built up in the same soldiers on parade way, with atoms regularly spaced in a fixed pattern that gives the whole crystal its shape. Indeed, that is what we mean by a crystal. Some soldiers are capable of parading in more than one way, producing very different crystals. Carbon atoms, if they parade in one way, make the legendarily hard diamond crystals. But if they adopt a different formation, they make crystals of graphite, so soft it is used as a lubricant. We think of crystals as beautiful, transparent objects, and we even describe other things like pure water as crystal clear. But actually, most solid stuff is made of crystals, and most solid stuff is not transparent. A lump of iron is made of lots of tiny crystals packed together, each crystal consisting of millions of iron atoms spaced out on parade like the carbon atoms in a diamond crystal. Lead, aluminum, gold, copper, all are made of crystals of their different kinds of atoms. So are rocks, like granite or sandstone, but they are often mixtures of lots of different kinds of tiny crystals all packed together. Sand is crystalline too. In fact, many sand grains are just little bits of rock ground down by water and wind. The same is true of mud, with the addition of water or other liquids. Often, sand grains and mud grains get packed together again to make new rocks, called sedimentary rocks, because they are hardened sediments of sand and mud. A sediment is the bits of solid stuff that settle in the bottom of a liquid, for example, in a river or lake or sea. The sand in sandstone is mostly made of quartz and feldspar, two common crystals in the Earth's crust. Limestone is different. Like chalk, it is calcium carbonate, and it comes from ground-down coral skeletons and seashells, including the shells of tiny, single-celled creatures called forams. If you see a very white beach, the sand is most likely calcium carbonate from the same shelly source. Sometimes, crystals are made entirely of the same kind of atoms on parade, all of the same element. Diamond, gold, copper, and iron are examples. But other crystals are made of two different kinds of atoms, again, on parade in strict order, alternating, for example. Salt, common salt, table salt, is not an element but a compound of two elements, sodium and chlorine. In a crystal of salt, the sodium and chlorine atoms parade together alternately. Actually, in this case, they are called not atoms, but ions. But I'm not going to go into why that is. Every sodium ion has six chlorines for neighbors at right angles to each other, in front, behind, to left, to right, above, and below. And every chlorine ion is surrounded by sodiums in just the same way. The whole arrangement is composed of squares, and this is why salt crystals, if you look at them carefully with a strong lens, are cubic, the three-dimensional form of a square, or at least have squared-off edges. Lots of other crystals are made of more than one kind of atom on parade, and many of them are found in rocks, sand, and soil. Solid, liquid, gas. How molecules move. Crystals are solid, but not everything is solid. We also have liquids and gases. In a gas, the molecules don't stick together as they do in a crystal, but rush freely about within whatever space is available, traveling in straight lines like billiard balls, but in three dimensions, not two as on a flat table. They rush about until they hit something, such as another molecule or the walls of a container, in which case they bounce off, again, like billiard balls. Gases can be compressed, which shows there is a lot of space between the atoms and molecules. When you compress a gas, it feels springy. Put your finger over the end of a bicycle pump and feel the springiness as you push the plunger in. If you keep your finger there, when you let the plunger go, it shoots back out. The springiness that you are feeling is called pressure. The pressure is the effect of all the millions of molecules of air, a mixture of nitrogen and oxygen and a few other gases, in the pump bombarding the plunger, and everything else but the plunger is the only part that can move in response. At high pressure, the bombardment happens at a higher rate. This will happen if the same number of gas molecules are confined in a smaller volume, for instance, when you push the plunger of a bicycle pump. Or it will happen if you raise the temperature, which makes the gas molecules charge about faster. A liquid is like a gas in that its molecules move around or flow. That's why both are called fluids, while solids aren't. But the molecules in a liquid are much closer to each other than the molecules in a gas. If you put a gas into a sealed tank, it fills every nook and cranny of the tank up to the top. The volume of gas rapidly expands to fill the whole tank. A liquid also fills every nook and cranny, but only up to a certain level. A given amount of liquid, unlike the same amount of gas, keeps a fixed volume, and gravity pulls it downwards, so it fills only as much as it needs of the tank, from the bottom upwards. That's because the molecules of a liquid stay close to each other. But, unlike those of a solid, they do slide around over each other, which is why a liquid behaves as a fluid. A solid doesn't even try to fill the tank, it just retains its shape. That's because the molecules of a solid don't slide around over each other like those of a liquid, but stay in roughly the same positions relative to their neighbors. I say roughly because even in a solid, the molecules do sort of jiggle about faster at higher temperatures. They just don't move far enough from their position in the crystal parade to affect its shape. Sometimes a liquid is viscous, like treacle. A viscous liquid flows, but so slowly that, although a very viscous liquid eventually fills the bottom part of the tank, it takes a long time to do so. Some liquids are so viscous, flow so slowly, that they might as well be solid. Substances of this kind behave like solids, even though they're not made of crystals. Glass is an example. Glass is said to flow, but so slowly that it takes centuries for us to notice. So, for practical purposes, we can treat glass as solid. Solid, liquid, and gas are the names we give to the three common phases of matter. many substances are capable of being all three at different temperatures. On Earth, methane is a gas. It's often called marsh gas because it bubbles up from marshes, and sometimes it catches fire and we see it lit up as eerie will-o'-the-wisps. But on a large, very cold moon of the planet Saturn, called Titan, there are lakes of liquid methane. If a planet were colder still, it might have rocks of frozen methane. We think of Mercury as a liquid, but that just means it's liquid at ordinary temperatures on Earth. Mercury is a solid metal if you leave it outside in the Arctic winter. Iron is a liquid if you heat it to a high enough temperature. Indeed, around the deep center of the Earth is a sea of liquid iron mixed with liquid nickel. For all I know, there may be very hot planets with oceans of liquid iron at the surface, and perhaps strange creatures swimming in them, although I doubt that. By our standards, the freezing point of iron is rather hot, so at the surface of the Earth, we usually encounter it as iron, cold iron. And the freezing point of Mercury is rather cold, so we usually encounter it as quicksilver. At the other end of the temperature scale, both Mercury and iron become gases if you heat them enough. Regarding iron and cold iron, Google it. It's from the poet Rudyard Kipling, whom I love, although he is rather unfashionable nowadays. Inside the atom. When we were imagining cutting matter into the smallest possible pieces at the beginning of this chapter, we stopped at the atom. An atom of lead is the smallest object that still deserves to be called lead. But can you really not cut an atom any further? And would an atom of lead actually look like a tiny little chip of lead? No, it wouldn't look like a tiny piece of lead. It wouldn't look like anything. That's because an atom is too small to be seen, even with a powerful microscope. And yes, you can cut an atom into even smaller pieces, but what you then get is no longer the same element, for reasons we shall soon see. What is more, this is very difficult to do, and it releases an alarming quantity of energy. That is why, for some people, the phrase splitting the atom has such an ominous ring to it. It was first done by the great New Zealand scientist Ernest Rutherford in 1919. Although we can't see an atom, and although we can't split it without turning it into something else, that doesn't mean we can't work out what it is like inside. As I explained in Chapter 1, when scientists can't see something directly, they propose a model of what it might be like, and then they test that model. A scientific model is a way of thinking about how things might be. So a model of the atom is a kind of mental picture of what the inside of an atom might be like. A scientific model can seem like a flight of fancy, but it is not just a flight of fancy. Scientists don't stop at proposing a model. They then go on to test it. They say, if this model that I am imagining were true, we would expect to see such and such in the real world. They predict what you'll find if you do a particular experiment and make certain measurements. A successful model is one whose predictions come out right, especially if they survive the test of experiment. And if the predictions come out right, we hope it means that the model probably represents the truth, or at least a part of the truth. Sometimes the predictions don't come out right, and so scientists go back and adjust the model or think up a new one and then go on to test that. Either way, this process of proposing a model and then testing it, what we call the scientific method, has a much better chance of getting at the way things really are than even the most imaginative and beautiful myth invented to explain what people didn't, and often, at the time, couldn't understand. An early model of the atom was the so-called current bun model proposed by the great English physicist JJ Thomson at the end of the 19th century. I won't describe it because it was replaced by the more successful Rutherford model, first proposed by the same Ernest Rutherford who split the atom, who came from New Zealand to England to work as Thomson's pupil, and who succeeded Thomson as Cambridge's professor of physics. The Rutherford model, later refined in turn by Rutherford's pupil, the celebrated Danish physicist Niels Bohr, treats the atom as a tiny, miniaturized solar system. There is a nucleus in the middle of the atom, which contains the bulk of its material. And there are tiny particles, called electrons, whizzing around the nucleus in orbit, though orbit may be misleading if you think of it as just like a planet orbiting the sun, because an electron is not a little round thing in a definite place. One surprising thing about the Rutherford-Bohr model, which probably reflects a real truth, is that the distance between each nucleus and the next is very large compared with the size of the nuclei, even in a hard chunk of solid matter like a diamond. The nuclei are hugely spaced out. This is the point I promised to return to. Remember I said that a diamond crystal is a giant molecule made of carbon atoms like soldiers on parade, but a parade in three dimensions? Well, we can now improve our model of the diamond crystal by giving it a scale, that is, a sense of how sizes and distances in it relate to one another. Suppose we represent the nucleus of each carbon atom in the crystal not by a soldier but by a football, with electrons in orbit around it. On this scale, the neighboring footballs in the diamond would be more than 15 kilometers away. The 15 kilometers between the footballs would contain the electrons in orbit around the nuclei. But each electron, on our football scale, is much smaller than a gnat, and these miniature gnats are themselves several kilometers away from the footballs they are flying around. So you can see that, amazingly, even the legendarily hard diamond is almost entirely empty space. The same is true of all rocks, no matter how hard and solid. It is true of iron and lead. It is also true of even the hardest wood, and it is true of you and me. I've said that solid matter is made of atoms packed together, but packed means something rather odd here, because the atoms themselves are mostly empty space. The nuclei of the atoms are spaced out so far apart that, if they were scaled up to footballs, any pair of them would be 15 kilometers apart with only a few gnats in between. How can this be? If a rock is almost entirely empty space, with the actual matter dotted about like footballs separated by kilometers from their nearest neighbors, how come it feels so hard and solid? Why doesn't it collapse like a house of cards when you sit on it? Why can't we see right through it? If both a wall and I are mostly empty space, why can't I walk straight through the wall? Actually, there is a rather funny story about a senior American soldier called General Stubblebine who tried to do just that. Here's the story, which I've already quoted in a previous book. This is a true story. It is the summer of 1983. Major General Albert Stubblebine III is sitting behind his desk in Arlington, Virginia, and he is staring at his wall, upon which hangs his numerous military awards. They detail a long and distinguished career. He is the United States Army's Chief of Intelligence, with 16,000 soldiers under his command. He looks past his awards to the wall itself. There is something he feels he must do, even though the thought of it frightens him. He thinks about the choice he has to make. He can stay in his office or he can go into the next office. That is his choice. and he has made it. He is going into the next office. He stands up, moves out from behind his desk, and begins to walk. I mean, he thinks, what is the atom mostly made up of anyway? Space. He quickens his pace. What am I mostly made of? He thinks, atoms. He is almost at a jog now. What is the wall mostly made up of? He thinks, atoms. All I have to do is merge the spaces. Then General Stubblebine bangs his nose hard on the wall of his office. Damn, he thinks. General Stubblebine is confounded by his continual failure to walk through his wall. You can't help feeling for General Stubblebine. He knew that the wall and his own body were made of atoms so spaced out that they were like footballs 15 kilometers apart. Surely, if both the wall and his own body were mostly empty space, he should be able to walk through the wall, slotting his atoms in between the wall's atoms. Why couldn't he? Why do rocks and walls feel hard, and why can't we merge our spaces with theirs? We have to realize, as poor General Stubblebine learned the hard way, that what we feel and see as solid matter is more than just nuclei and electrons, the footballs and the gnats. Scientists talk about forces and bonds and fields, which act in their different ways, both to keep the footballs apart and to keep the components of each football together. And it is those forces and fields that make things feel solid. When you get down to really small things like atoms and nuclei, the distinction between matter and empty space starts to lose its meaning. It isn't really right to say that the nucleus is matter like a soccer ball and that there is empty space until the next nucleus. We define solid matter as what you can't walk through. You can't walk through a wall because of these mysterious forces that link the nuclei to their neighbors in a fixed position. That's what solid means. Liquid means something similar, except that the mysterious fields and forces hold the atoms together less tightly, so they slide over each other, which means that you can walk through water, although not so fast as you can walk through air. Air, being a gas, a mixture of gases actually, is easy to walk through because the atoms in a gas whiz about freely, rather than being tied to each other. A gas becomes difficult to walk through only if most of the atoms are whizzing in the same direction and it is the opposite direction to the one in which you are trying to walk. This is what happens when you are trying to walk against the wind. That's what wind means. It can be difficult to walk against a strong gale and impossible against a hurricane or against the artificial gale hurled out behind a jet engine. We can't walk through solid matter, but some very small particles, such as the ones called photons, can. Light beams are streams of photons, and they can go right through some kinds of solid matter, the kinds we call transparent. Something about the way the footballs are arranged in glass or in water or in certain gemstones means that photons can pass right between them, although they are slowed down a bit, just as you are slowed down when you try to walk through water. With a few exceptions like quartz crystals, rocks aren't transparent and photons can't pass through them. Instead, depending on the rock's color, they are either absorbed by the rock or reflected from its surface, and the same is true of most other solid things. A few solid things reflect photons in a very special straight line way, and we call them mirrors. But most solid things absorb many of the photons. They aren't transparent, and scatter even the ones that they reflect. They don't behave like mirrors. We just see them as opaque, and we also see them as having a color, which depends on which kinds of photons they absorb and which kinds they reflect. I'll return to the important subject of color in Chapter 7 What is a rainbow? Meanwhile, we need to shrink our vision to the very small indeed and look right inside the nucleus, the football itself. The tiniest things of all. The nucleus isn't really like a football. That was just a crude model. It certainly isn't round like a football. It isn't even clear whether we should speak of it as having a shape at all. Maybe the very word shape, like the word solid, loses all meaning down at these very tiny sizes. And we are talking very, very tiny indeed. The full stop at the end of this sentence contains about a million million atoms of printing ink. Each nucleus contains smaller particles called protons and neutrons. You can think of them as balls too, if you like, but like the nuclei, they are not really balls. Protons and neutrons are approximately the same size as each other. They are very, very tiny indeed, but even so, they are still 1,000 times bigger than the electrons, gnats, in orbit around the nucleus. The main difference between a proton and a neutron is that the proton has an electric charge. Electrons, too, have an electric charge, opposite to that of protons. We needn't bother with exactly what electric charge means here. Neutrons have no charge. Because electrons are so very, very, very tiny, while protons and neutrons are only very, very tiny, the mass of an atom is, to all intents and purposes, just its protons and neutrons. What does mass mean? Well, you can think of mass as rather like weight, and you can measure it using the same units as weight, grams or pounds. Weight is not the same as mass, however, and I'll need to explain the difference, but I'm postponing that to the next chapter. For the moment, just think of mass as something like weight. The mass of an object depends almost entirely on how many protons and neutrons it has in all its atoms added together. The number of protons in the nucleus of any atom of a particular element is always the same and is equal to the number of electrons in orbit around the nucleus, although the electrons don't contribute noticeably to the mass because they are too small. A hydrogen atom has only one proton and one electron. A uranium atom has 92 protons. Lead has 82. Carbon has 6. For every possible number from 1 to 100 and a few more, there is one and only one element that has that number of protons and the same number of electrons. I won't list them all, but it would be easy to do so. Lala, my wife, can recite them all by heart at great speed, a trick she taught herself as an exercise in training her memory and as a device to help her get to sleep. The number of protons or electrons that an element possesses is called the atomic number of that element. So you can identify an element not just by its name, but by its own unique atomic number. For example, element number 6 is carbon. Element number 82 is lead. The elements are conveniently set out in a table called the periodic table. I won't go into why it's called that, although it is interesting. But now is the moment to return, as I promised I would, to the question of why. When you cut a piece of, say, lead into smaller and smaller pieces, you eventually reach a point where, if you cut it again, it is no longer lead. An atom of lead has 82 protons. If you split the atom so that it no longer has 82 protons, it ceases to be lead. The number of neutrons in an atom's nucleus is less fixed than the number of protons. Many elements have different versions, called isotopes, with different numbers of neutrons. For example, there are three isotopes of carbon, called carbon-12, carbon-13, and carbon-14. The numbers refer to the mass of the atom, which is the sum of the protons and neutrons. Each of the three has 6 protons. Carbon 12 has 6 neutrons, carbon 13 has 7 neutrons, and carbon 14 has 8 neutrons. Some isotopes, for example carbon 14, are radioactive, which means they change into other elements at a predictable rate, although at unpredictable moments. Scientists can use this feature to help them calculate the age of fossils. Carbon 14 is used to date things younger than most fossils, for example, ancient wooden ships. Well then, does our quest to cut things even smaller and smaller end with these three particles, electrons, protons, and neutrons? No. Even protons and neutrons have an inside. Even they contain yet smaller things called quarks. But that is something I'm not going to talk about in this book. That's not because I think you wouldn't understand it. It is because I know I don't understand it. We are here moving into a wonderland of the mysterious, and it is important to recognize when we reach the limits of what we understand. It is not that we shall never understand these things. Probably we shall, and scientists are working on them with every hope of success. But we have to know what we don't understand and admit it to ourselves before we can begin to work on it. There are scientists who understand at least something of this wonderland of the very small, but I am not one of them. I know my limitations. Carbon, the scaffolding of life. All the elements are special in their different ways, but one element, carbon, is so special that I want to end the chapter by talking briefly about that. Carbon chemistry even has its own name, separating it from the whole of the rest of chemistry, organic chemistry. All the rest of chemistry is inorganic chemistry. So what is so special about carbon? The answer is that carbon atoms link up with other carbon atoms to form chains. The chemical compound octane above, which, as you may know, is an ingredient of petrol, gasoline, is a rather short chain of 8 carbon atoms, the black blobs in the illustration, with hydrogen atoms, the gray blobs, sticking out to the sides. The wonderful thing about carbon is that it can make chains of any length, some literally hundreds of carbon atoms long. Sometimes the chains come around in a loop. For example, above right is naphthalene, the substance that mothballs are made of, whose molecules are also made of carbon with hydrogen attached, this time in 2 loops. Carbon chemistry is rather like the toy construction kit called Tinker Toy. In the laboratory, chemists have succeeded in making carbon atoms join up with each other, not just in simple loops, but in wonderfully shaped Tinker Toy-like molecules nicknamed Buckyballs and Bucky Tubes. Bucky was the nickname of Buckminster Fuller, the great American architect who invented the geodesic dome. You can see the connection if you look at the picture below. The buckyballs and bucky tubes scientists have made are artificial molecules, but they show the Tinker Toyish way in which carbon atoms can be joined together into scaffolding-like structures that can be indefinitely large. Just recently, the exciting news was announced that buckyballs have been detected in outer space in the dust drifting near to a distant star. Carbon chemistry offers a near infinite number of possible molecules, all of different shapes, and thousands of different ones are found in living bodies. Above is one very large molecule called myoglobin, which is found in millions of copies in all our muscles. The illustration does not show the individual atoms, just the bonds joining them. Not all the atoms in myoglobin are carbon atoms, but it is the carbon atoms that join together in these fascinating Tinker Toy-like scaffolding structures. And that is really what makes life possible. when you think that myoglobin is only one example among thousands of equally complicated molecules in living cells, you can perhaps imagine that, just as you can build pretty much anything you like if you have a large enough tinker toy set, so the chemistry of carbon provides the vast range of possible forms required to put together anything so complicated as a living organism. What? No myths? This chapter has been unusual in that it didn't begin with a list of myths. This was only because it was so hard to find any myths on this subject. Unlike, say, the sun or the rainbow or earthquakes, the fascinating world of the very small never came to the notice of primitive peoples. If you think about this for a minute, it's not really surprising. They had no way of even knowing it was there, and so of course they didn't invent any myths to explain it. It wasn't until the microscope was invented in the 16th century that people discovered that ponds and lakes, soil and dust, even our own bodies, teem with tiny living creatures, too small to see, yet complicated and, in their own way, beautiful, or perhaps frightening, depending on how you think about them. The creatures in the picture below are dust mites, distantly related to spiders, but too small to see except as tiny specks. There are thousands of them in every home, crawling through every carpet and every bed, quite probably including yours. If primitive peoples had known about them, you can imagine what myths and legends they might have invented to explain them. But before the invention of the microscope, their existence was not even dreamed of. And so there are no myths about them. And, small as it is, even a dust mite contains more than 100 trillion atoms. Dust mites are too small for us to see, but the cells of which they are made are smaller still. The bacteria that live inside them and us, in vast numbers, are smaller even than that. And atoms are far, far smaller even than bacteria. The whole world is made of incredibly tiny things, much too small to be visible to the naked eye, and yet none of the myths or so-called holy books that some people, even now, think were given to us by an all-knowing God mentions them at all. In fact, when you look at those myths and stories, you can see that they don't contain any of the knowledge that science has patiently worked out. They don't tell us how big or how old the universe is. They don't tell us how to treat cancer. They don't explain gravity or the internal combustion engine. They don't tell us about germs or nuclear fusion or electricity or anesthetics. In fact, unsurprisingly, the stories in holy books don't contain any more information about the world than was known to the primitive peoples who first started telling them. If these holy books really were written or dictated or inspired by all-knowing gods, don't you think it's odd that those gods said nothing about any of these important and useful things?